Welcome students to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Anuradha Sovani. I am professor and head of psychology at SNGT Women's University at Mumbai. And today I am going to bring to you something that is very much part of all our lives: growth and development in childhood. This is something that we need to understand before we understand how we shaped up the way we are. Early experiences in a child's life actually builds the base for how they become in the future, how they develop socially, emotionally, and so on. So the optimum kind of childhood experience as they are growing up is going to really maximize the success that they will have and their future well-being. So understanding the nature, the steps in child development will help us to understand what to expect when they have grown up. As the child is growing and developing, what sort of changes go through the child? So in this course, some of the things that will happen by the end of the course is that the learner will be able to know how child development occurs. What is the importance of growth and development in the stages, different stages of a child's life? What is the meaning of growth and development? How are the two different, growth and development? What are the underlying principles? What are the factors affecting this particular phenomenon of growth and development of the child? Which domains do children grow and develop in? So many. There is the physical domain, cognitive domain, social, emotional domain, and of course the domain of language. Let us look at what is the importance of growth and development. What we really want over here is a good knowledge of the normal growth and development of children, which helps us to recognize that each child is very unique. Each person's stages of growth and development will differ a little bit. So a realistic understanding and a realistic expectation of the child's performance at different developmental stages, how the child will play at that stage, what activities they will indulge in that stage, is very important. So for educators, this is an important thing to know, that how much can we expect of every child at every stage? What are the optimal stages to teach certain things to a child in their process of growth and development? How can we monitor growth and development of a child? Detect any deviations if there are? How will we know that a child is developing slowly or in an accelerated way? These are some of the things that we will be able to address in this module, and then we'll also be able to see in what way we can intervene, in what way we can help, say if there is a developmental delay. So we can keep a check on the various stages of development, the developmental changes that are occurring in the child. Generally, children learn as different developmental stages develop in their lives, they learn different skills. So they'll be able to pick up certain skills at typical ages in their lives. For example, language skills. A child might pick up language skills at a certain stage. They might be able to pick up writing skills after that. So if there is a delay in one stage, there may be a delay in the next stage. So a child might start speaking late because of a delay in language skills. Social and emotional skills also develop at certain ages. So we need to intervene if there are problems at certain stages, and we start realizing that this is so and we have to take some steps to overcome this. So different areas of development and early intervention, if we find a problem with one of those areas of development, will not only help the improvement in the growth and development, but will also increase self-esteem in the child. Will also improve the child's self-image, because they are correcting wherever things are going wrong. In school activities also, we need to plan which class, which level can we introduce certain language skills, reading skills, writing skills, speaking skills, and so on. So let us look at this concept of growth and development. The terms also, growth and development, are two different terms. Very often we use them interchangeably, but that is wrong. They are actually quite different. We need to understand this. What is the difference between them? Growth actually refers to actual biological growth, quantitative growth. quantitative increase in size, in weight, enlargement of different organs in the body, head size for example, hand size and so on. So more cells which are growing, and because of which arm length, leg length, height, weight, all this will increase in the child. This is the growth process. Development on the other hand refers to a qualitative change. So quantitative versus qualitative. Development refers to a progressive increase in the capacities to do certain things. So the capacity to learn through observation, qualitative changes in the way a child grasps certain things. So not only growth but also development is just as important. It is not enough for the child to just physically grow. It must also develop. There are certain very basic scientific principles of growth and development which we will try to understand in this section. Development is continuous. The process of growth and development will change from different life stages to the others, but it will continue from one stage to the other till the individual reaches maturity. So the child will gradually continue to grow quantitatively and qualitatively until maximum growth is achieved, continuously throughout their lifespan till they reach a certain level of maturity, till that maturity is gained, is attained. So it is continuous. Development is also gradual. It does not happen all of a sudden. It doesn't happen in spurts. It is slowly cumulative. Okay, so slowly by slowly at each stage, sequentially, predictably, we will know that now this child is now going to go to the next stage. Every species, like humans for example, have their own flow chart, their own developmental chart, their own expectations of what patterns will emerge at which stage in life. When a child will crawl, when a child will start then slowly sitting up, then standing, then walking, climbing steps will all happen one after the other. Keep in mind that rate of development also varies from person to person. It is not uniform. No two people will develop at the exact same rate. It will differ across people, across different stages in life, even across genders. Boys and girls will have different patterns of development. Parts of the body will develop. I will show you later, you have a cephalochordal kind of pattern. What parts grow faster than which other parts of the body, how, which period of life boys gain height, girls gain height, all this is different and there is a pattern to it. Development occurs according to growth gradients. There are differential developmental gradients, differential developmental patterns that are laid down, that are well established. The science knows that, as I just now mentioned for example, cephalochordal growth. Science knows that there is top-down growth. So head size will increase, say, before the length of legs will increase. Or changes in the upper half, in the shoulders and so on, will happen before the lower half. Proximodistal, central parts of the body will improve or develop or grow faster than the extremities. So proximodistal, cephalochordal, these are the principles. Let us take examples of little children, infants. They will approach unknown objects, strange objects. They may not have any fear. They may not understand that certain things can harm them. They might just go out and touch anything, because till then that fear, that anxiety has not developed. If they are hurt, they will start crying, but they will not anticipate that they can get hurt. Developmentally, slowly, newer and newer understanding will grow in the child. So mental development will occur just as motor development occurs. And very soon you will find that the child is able to reach a next superior level. They will start showing other attributes, social attributes. They will start showing different emotions. So growth and development is a product of all this. Two important factors, heredity and environment. Development is influenced by both heredity and environment. Both have a very, very important role to play in growth and development. Development will occur, as I said, in very specific periods, which are called critical periods of growth and development. There are certain lifespan periods in the child's growing years where there is maximal potential for growth. So we also have to provide the environmental stimulus for this. Physical growth, emotional growth, social growth can be seriously hampered if the conditions for growth and development are not good in these sensitive periods. So the different rates of growth and development are much influenced by both these factors: what is innate in the child and also what is provided from the environment. What are the environmental influences? There is a constant kind of interaction between the internal factors which are innate in the child and this kind of external influence, and the best combination with very, very good environmental stimulation and good natural internal growth and development also will give you the best potential results. So socially, intellectually, emotionally, physically, the child will grow best given all these factors. What are some of these factors affecting growth and development? Let us study that. One very important factor is the genetic factor, hereditary factors, which has a major influence in how a body is formed, how the child grows, how tall a child can get, for example, what is the eye color, what is the hair color, all these things. There can also be certain genetic disorders which are inherited, different characteristics which slowly manifest one by one with genetics: intelligence, aptitudes, body structure, height and weight, eye color, as I said, all this is very influenced by heredity. Sometimes it is not possible to exactly pinpoint which genetic factors played a role, what actually played a role in the emergence of certain characteristics in the child, but it is there. Nutrition is another very important factor. As I said, there are some environmental factors also. So poor nutrition at the very important, significant, critical period, malnutrition, can lead to very poor growth in the child, stunted growth. So nutritional support, nutritional requirements is very necessary to have a healthy child, a well-growing child. And this factor is always reflected. In different countries, we will see where there is a lot of poverty, where the family cannot give proper nutrition. In the mother, pregnant mother, there is not proper nutrition. The food doesn't contain the basic ingredients that the mother should have when she has the baby growing inside her. Proteins, vitamins, all the different components which must be there in food. Then you will find the child suffers. The World Health Organization, the WHO, has also taken up a lot of steps to ensure that the proper nutrition is obtained by the mother and by the growing child. Another important factor is also the gender. What sort of differences there are in growth and development of boys and girls, of men and women, before they reach complete maturity. So we know, for example, that physical growth of girls in the teens is very fast. The body structure, the growth is very early. Girls will shoot up much earlier than boys. So gender is also a very important factor. Socioeconomic conditions matter. Again, remember, that is linked to nutrition, that is linked to environmental influences in growth and development. What sort of sanitary conditions children grow up in? What sort of infections they pick up? Parasitic kind of infections that they may pick up because of dirty environments, unclean environments, unhygienic environments. What sort of financial situations they grow up in? Do they get the proper medicines? Do they get the proper food? All these things will make a lot of difference. So socioeconomic conditions also matter to give a child a chance to grow optimally and develop optimally. So environmental conditions that are physical, that are psychological, that are social, that are cultural will all affect growth and development. If you kind of create a cultural setup, for example, that is unfair to girls, which doesn't give proper education to girls, the community will be affected. The urban and rural setup will play a role because of the kind of stimulation that is available to children. Whether pollution is there or not will play a role. Another factor is things like chronic diseases which might affect a population. Diseases of the heart, lungs. If all these happen early in life for a child, they will stunt growth. Hormonal deficiencies can stunt growth. Diseases are there such as Cushing's syndrome, such as various other conditions which are resulting because of hormonal deficiencies. Another very important area is emotional growth. if a person is exposed to a lot of traumatic situations in their childhood, that will definitely play a role. Intrauterine conditions, infections and diseases which hit the mother when the child is still intrauterine, maternal diabetes, various other conditions, as I said earlier, malnutrition of course, but other than that also, many, many other things that affect the mother will affect the growth of the child. It will affect the growth potential of the child. Many of these children will actually be smaller, will actually have lower birth weight. And then these children cannot develop as well as a child who is born healthy. They've already got an kind of interrupting influence in their early years. So all these factors we must keep in mind is going to play a role in the bodily constitution, in the growth, in the development of the child. All these are important principles to keep in mind before we actually understand properly why certain children in the community, certain adults in the community have small physical stature, have certain facial features, seem to have not got a proper growth and development chance. Now let us actually track what happens, you know, to a small child between say 3 years to 12 years, very, very crucial period in the growth of a child. What really happens at say the 3-year level? Say physically, growth is steadily happening. It is slower than the first 2 years, but it is steadily happening. Height can be predicted at this stage. You can already make out by 3 whether this person is going to be a tall person or not later in life. So all these things are sort of forming their blueprint at this early stage. Legs start growing faster. Legs get longer, so the height increases. Circumference of the head and chest, head size, all these proportions start changing. Baby fat starts disappearing. A child that looks very chubby and sweet at age 2 can start looking thinner. Posture can change. Different kinds of positions. The child can look a little knock-kneed because, you know, they're very thin and bony and skinny. Then the child is also now walking around. The child is moving around. So all these changes are also happening in the child. So the child walks up and down stairs. Child can walk unassisted, they don't need to hold somebody's hand, they may start jumping from a height. So all these different stages and changes can happen. A child can also, you know, kick a ball. So all this should come into their playing activity. They should not get so much assistance that they will not learn to do these things on their own. Throwing a ball, riding a bicycle, jumping into the water, catching an object, climbing stairs up and down, swinging, all these activities should be allowed at this age. A child will also start playing with crayons and markers, will start using colors, will hold the crayon or the marker in a nice way, you know, like how we hold a pencil. So that correct grasp is also important. It's no use trying to teach a child to hold a pencil when he's too immature to do it. They will also learn to turn pages of books in a particular way. They will learn to build, you know, blocks, build towers out of blocks, to squeeze paint tubes and get things out of them, carry things from one place to the other, carry them carefully, you know, like carrying a cup of liquid like milk or water without spilling. So all these are very important skills that the child has to learn. They must learn to manipulate objects also. A child is slowly learning to dress himself, wash himself, clean himself, brush his teeth. So buttoning, unbuttoning, zipping, you know, washing hands, washing the mouth, all this must be slowly learnt. The child also learns bladder control. So these are important steps at this stage. Cognitive changes are also age appropriate. So even in a classroom, even if a child is attending class, there will be these challenges to be able to look at books, to be able to identify objects, name objects, guess what is there, what is missing, right? Speech is developing. So they start kind of developing certain phrases. They're not saying single words. They're making sentences. They're trying to show what comes before what. They're trying to guess what the other person is trying to say. Answering questions. So somebody asks them, what are you doing? They will say, I'm going to play or I'm going to do some drawing. So all this is happening at the third year level. At fourth year, even more changes start happening. Fifth year, it's even faster. So a child is slowly learning the correct way in which language should be used. They will correct you. They will say, don't say it this way, say it that way, how their teacher has taught them. Motor development, walking in a straight line, balancing, right? Hopping from one foot to the other, pedaling a cycle, turning corners, avoiding objects, obstacles, all this they will learn. So what is important, what I'm trying to highlight here is, let the child play in the playground. Let them play on equipment. Let them try their skill, running about, jumping about, trying their way through obstacles. Don't overprotect them. Don't let them become afraid to try out all these different things. They will have to learn to do this, and it is developmentally very, very important for them. I told you the child is learning to hold a crayon or a marker. Now they will also learn to paint. They will also try painting. They will try to make certain shapes like squares, rectangles, triangles. So we want them to learn all this. Things that they can't get hurt doing, like don't give them a hammer and nail to play with, but they can have a toy hammer and a toy nail and they can learn how to do it. Cognitively also changes will start happening. They will learn newer and newer words. They will learn new names. They will learn the meanings of things. So all this is to be encouraged. Give them a lot of alphabet books. Give them a lot of jigsaw puzzles, pictures, so that they challenge themselves, they stimulate themselves. The child enjoys doing all these things. Let them develop their language. Let them understand the meaning of certain words, you know, like big, bigger, biggest, relatively. Let them understand sequences of events. What happens first? What happens later? What happens when you go to school? First in the morning, what happens? After that, what happens? So this is also important. They are recognizing things, they are learning to replace words with other words and so on. Now, what we also want to understand is how language changes slowly. So now, let us look at like possessive nouns, you know, mine, yours, numbers, how much, how many. Different aspects of speech that develops, like understanding labels for children, for people, names of children. Labels for people in the family, like grandfather, grandmother, dad, mom, all these things. They also learn to make up stories, right? They say, this happened, baby had his milk, my brother did this. So they are talking about other people in the environment. They are answering questions. So this is a very important stage in their cognitive growth and development. Socially, what happens? Let us see. Socially, the child starts becoming more outgoing. They of course have a lot of mood swings. They might get angry unpredictably, they may laugh unpredictably, you know, fool around with other children, throw tantrums. So it's considered to be a very complicated age, a very tough age to deal with. But that's good because they are learning to develop and interact with their social environment. Their imagination is growing. They are starting to form imaginary stories, create songs, create sounds, you know, make things with their hands, maybe build sand castles, make models. So all these is a very, very good thing, because then they learn to be proud. This is what I drew, this is what I made. So you put it up on a notice board or you show it to other adults in the environment. This is going to help them a great deal. Later, as the child grows even more, even kind of goes into the next stage of life, they start enjoying role playing. So this is a very important stage. They might play the role of a teacher, or like, you know, you become dad, I'll become mom, you will play. So they will pretend. It's called pretend play. They might have birthday parties, they might also do negative things. They may start teasing other children, fighting with other children, taunting other children. But this is part of the playfulness of growing up. Let's look quickly at what happens when a child is 5. Physically, now of course we've learned to anticipate, you know, that head size is increasing, height is increasing, baby talk is going down, that baby fat is no longer there, motor development is happening. Now one very important thing happens here, they'll develop a lot of independence, you know, they'll run up and down stairs, they can even walk backwards. So they want to try all these things in the school, at home, they will turn somersaults, they will jump and so on. So this is good for their growth, it is good for their balance, it is good for their gait. All these activities should be encouraged. Teaching them to throw a ball, catch a ball and so on should be encouraged. We've talked of bicycles and running and jumping and all that. We've talked of it earlier. Building different models, right? Drawing shapes, all this should be encouraged. Teaching them to write letters, by this time they can. Shape alphabets. Cutting with a child-friendly scissor, which of course should be a scissor that doesn't hurt them, but cutting, sticking, drawing shapes, making shapes with clay. Cognitively, they also start understanding these shapes, building two-dimensional, three-dimensional shapes out of blocks and so on. So all these kind of toys are very nice at this stage. Rather than giving them passive toys, which they're just watching something on a screen, they should be given these kind of toys, where they're learning new and new things, where their attention span is also going up. They can pay attention for longer and longer times. They can start following a story. What is happening in a story? The parent may be telling them a story, they will understand, and so on. They will start slowly understanding right and wrong. They will also start developing handedness, which is their dominant hand, right hand, left hand. Don't push them to use the right hand or use the left hand. Let it be natural. They will slowly start understanding time, read the clock, understanding dates on a calendar. So these are very, very valuable learnings for a child, because it's in real life around them. They're understanding the impact of days and dates and months and time and clocks and all that. So they can actually start using all this information in their day-to-day life. They're very curious. They're very inquisitive. Vocabulary is growing. They can understand different new words, which are kind of increasing in their vocabulary. So this 4, 5, 6 year old is a very important period in their lives. So now let us go on tracking this child as he is growing older. Of course, you can read up about all this in much more detail. So let us, you know, go a little further. I'm going now to a little older child, like maybe a 7 year old child. What is happening now? Remember that this child is now very active in school. Okay, so a 7 year old child has his own friends, he has his own peer group, he or her, whoever it is, boy or girl. So now they are learning a lot more of social behavior. At the 7th year, this child has now gone out of nursery school and so on. Their language has also become quite mature. They learn how to tease other children, how to pull other children's legs, how to report events at home, what happened in school today. So they're becoming quite mature with a lot of their activities. So this is a very crucial age. A lot of friendships are forming at this age. They are learning to get along with their peer group. They are learning how to adjust, right? So in a 7 year old, now you are looking at some motor changes, some bodily changes. They are becoming more and more adept at doing the same things that they were doing earlier, like bicycles or jumping and, you know, running and all that. But more importantly, now their language. They understand numbers, they are capable of making big sentences, making, you know, long stories, creating all kinds of scenarios. Socially and emotionally, they are becoming very adept. They are passing through this stage, which is a very important stage, because ethically they are understanding what is right and wrong, what is telling lies, what is stealing, correct? So this is a very important age for social and emotional development also. As you move to an even older child, an 8 year old, what you see over here is that, other than, as I said, limb length, strength, all these things, the child also now wants to understand what is happening around them. They want to start thinking logically. They start questioning you at 8 or 9 years. Why do I have to do this way? Why is this right? Why is that wrong? So don't lose patience with them. Try and answer all these questions, because the child is learning slowly to question things around them. So let's see, as a child is getting even older, by 9, they are like almost fully grown. Manual dexterity is very good. They can do things, you know, draw, paint, cut, stick, right hand, left hand, everything. Language has become very, very developed. They can learn by heart. They can recite poetry. They can even create their own stories, create their own language. So it's very important to encourage all this in the child. Encourage the child to build stories, to interact socially with each other, to engage in social behaviors. Even if they come back and fight, even if they complain, you know, even if they don't like playing with certain children, all this is still very, very good learning for them at this stage. We now move towards the end of this whole program. We are looking at 10, 11 year olds. We are seeing much older children. Very interestingly, today we actually see that they're close to being teenage, although they're not actually yet teenagers. But they have very strong views of their own. They have a lot of social life. They have very strongly formed friendships. They have a lot of temper. You know, when you start interfering with these friendships, they don't like it. They have certain peer groups that they have created for themselves. They don't want to include younger children in their peer group. So now they're becoming quite adult-like in some ways, right? They can be a little restless, a little jumpy at this age. You might also have secondary sexual characteristics developing in girls by around 12. You can start expecting certain characteristics such as the physical changes in the body with puberty happening in girls. With boys, it comes later. But by 12-year-old, all this is happening. Now, this is also important because then socially, it affects things like their body image, how they want to dress, how they want to appear to the opposite sex, right? So this is a very important age for them because they are actually kind of worried now about how they appear to others, how adults should not interfere in their social life and so on. By 12 or so, even boys start developing certain changes. For some boys, there may be certain changes in their voice and so on. They start becoming very kind of independent now with their homework, with their social skills. They are very sensitive now about, parents interfering with their friendships, with their social interactions. In today's world, also social media is beginning to play a role. They start developing interest in the opposite sex. They start developing interest in going online and learning things. So one as parent or as teacher has to be quite cautious and yet allow them their freedom. So in summary, what we've tried to do is we've tried to see the social, emotional, physical growth of children over these different stages of life. The importance of growth and development. The importance of catching critical periods, developmentally critical periods at very, very crucial times so that the child can maximally develop potential. Catch each developmental period, critical period, allow the child to develop self-esteem, allow the child to actually reach their maximum potential of growth and development. So as we said, development is qualitative, growth is quantitative, and both has to keep on occurring in a very, very healthy way, balancing the genetic factors, the environmental factors, trying to catch growth gradients, trying to catch the most kind of crucial phases of growth and development in the child, because the child is actually finally a sum total of heredity, environment, training, the different exposure they get, the different stimulation they get from their environment, the role models they see in their adults. We have tried to see how the physical domain, motor, cognitive, social, all this rapidly goes on changing till the age of 12. So by the 12th year in the child's life, it is quite an independent individual who has, the child has a mind of his or her own, and as adults they become very interesting people to interact with. The potential in that age child is huge and it is very important for us to tap it. I hope you have enjoyed this entire interaction about growth and development in children. I think it's a very important area. All of us need to understand it as from the psychological point of view and as human beings in general, as people who are interested in education as a field in general, adult education in general. So we will stop here today. Thank you very much. You have been very attentive, I'm sure. This is Dr. Anuradha Sovni from Department of Psychology, professor and head here at SNDT at Mumbai. Thank you very much.